Rivas made an introduction for me, which was really flattering, but I just need to add that I'm not just a journalist. I've worked in documentaries before, and I've worked as a part of teams that have made theater plays, films, video clips. So I have a good general idea about stuff, and even fun news bulletins. Okay, so I've seen a lot of different angles of it. Even though I haven't worked in a newspaper, because I find it as a dead art, to be honest, or dying art.
It is a dying art.
From which you have a lot to take from, I have to say. So, this is more or less what I'm thinking we should discuss. What is the what is journalism in general? I'll tell you a little bit about my story, about developing skills, challenges and mistakes, some hints, and then of course we can have questions. This might happen in the other room, I'm not sure.
I think because it's only four of you and three of us, it will probably be better if it happens on the fly as we go. So whatever you think of asking, ask it. So we won't need to change the room, and I'm guessing 2 hours will be enough. So, if you start saying what you were going to say, and we'll see how it goes.
All right.
And we won't probably need to change room.
So, since you're students of journalism, I would like to ask you, what is your opinion?
They're not students of journalism, these particular ones, but they are doing modules related to journalism, for example, the one that I was leading. But this is a valid question.
I mean, without a specific, like, open a, you know, a dictionary and explain what it is. Do you have an idea, more or less, in your mind, of what is a journalist?
I will not use it against you if you don't answer that, but go
ahead. Me neither, I have to say.
So someone who's going to tell us what they found out about the world that might affect us, hopefully.
Mm-hmm. Valid point,
people that
I would say.
Numbers.
Sorry?
People that inform others.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Someone who's paid to tell stories, not write their opinion. Well, they can write their opinion, they can.
To be honest, after 13 years since I started thinking, oh, I want to become a journalist, I still haven't found a solid answer on what a journalist is, okay? And I still haven't decided what I want to do when I grow up either. So, this is something that evolves a lot as well, so it's more and more difficult to make a definition, I think. But I can tell you about what I've already experienced, which is mainly what is being a student of journalism and what it was, in my opinion, before. Okay. So I think these bullet points show more or less what I think is important in terms of journalism. One of the main things why I wanted to come here was to see how the BBC operates, not as a foreigner, but as somebody who's a citizen here. So I used to watch the news a lot back home as well, but when I came here, I watched it even more to understand how the highest level of journalism on TV, because I'm mainly on TV and on social websites, operate. So you need to watch the news a lot, you need to follow a lot of blogs, and this is, I have it as second most important, because I think that this is the future. I mean, we're stopping slowly getting having the importance of television and newspapers and basically big organizations that have their own interests or their state interests. And we're going more towards citizen journalism, where everybody can tell their opinion or some facts. Read, of course, newspapers, especially, I think, newspapers like The Independent, because you need to read comments from experienced people. Not to agree with them, but they actually open your mind. This is very important. Listen to the radio as much as you can, more for artistic reasons and not for political and journalistic reasons, I would say. It's an art, and it's not a dying art, it will continue. It's the most open and direct, I think. Other than that, you need to chase doing amateur work, whether that is doing work experience or doing something by yourself, or, you know, get involved in the university with the TV station, radio station, website. These are very important things that you can actually get experience from.
Just to point out here, this is a good comment, and I think you can still, if you want to get involved with the university radio, you're still eligible, so you can still do it even after getting graduated. There are a couple of people that you need to come to contact to. Andrew Benning is one of them. I know if you want to do this, I know the people to talk to. So this is still valid even if you're graduating in a couple of weeks.
Making something on your own is a very important point in my opinion as well. I'll give you an example that I wanted to say later, but in July when we had the riots in London, I was basically filming on my own among the people that were rioting just by using my phone and nothing else. And I was emailing my work 30-second clips. And this was a news bulletin that basically was going out on Sky News constantly on repeat. Because there was no possibility that somebody could go with a traditional method of getting a big camera on the shoulder and not being robbed, you know. So this could be something that some of you ladies could have done easily and put it up on your blog or on your YouTube channel or Vimeo channel. I don't know if you're familiar with Vimeo. It's very, it's like an official YouTube channel for journalists mainly and artistic. And make contacts. This is very important. Maybe the most important. I mean, that's how you chase your luck, which I'm going to talk about a lot later. So this is my story. You don't need to read all this. I just have it so that you know more or less. You know, I went to a French school because I was born in Canada. My parents wanted me to speak French. I went to a first university in Lesbos. There was a transfer that you could do back then. I chased it, and that's how I went to the Athens University, because I wanted to make contacts and I wanted to be closer to where the action was. And believe me, the action in Athens is not just the last couple of years that you've seen it on the news. This is a situation constantly, you know. But now that we have the economic crisis, that's why you see it a lot.
Can I just interrupt you again? This is also relevant to the fact that because Vasilis was interested in the media sector, most of the media activity in Greece is in Athens, in the same way that most of it for here is in London. But you have the advantage that London isn't actually far away from here. You're a train ride away, and it's not a very long train ride. So, for example, from Lesbos Island, it wasn't an easy thing to go to Athens. How long did it take?
16 hours with a boat.
16 hours by boat. So you
and the plane was a little bit too expensive. No. Proper boat.
So you have an advantage for that in terms of, and I'm not talking specifically for journalism, but because the majority of media-related jobs are in London, you have the advantage that you don't need to move there to go after them. You could do it from here, and then if something comes up, of course, you can move there if you so desire, but start the procedure of applying and starting to make contacts, it can happen actually living here. You will need to spend some time there, which may be problematic if you work. Okay, so it's difficult to have a proper, you know, full-time job here and then chase things in London. But it can be done, and in the same sense that the guys have come here to do a lecture here, which it could have happened, you know, even they could have left London this morning, as it happens again last night, but they could have left London this morning and they can go back home that same day. You could do the same. It takes a lot of chasing after, and it can be done because you're very near London. But of course, as you know, there are a lot of local media around the area. Kent is very heavily populated, so there are all things here as well. So don't dismiss opportunities and chances. A lot of things do happen. I mean, for you here, also networking, this is an opportunity. You can network with these two wonderful people, and they can become somebody who could link you to someone else. This has happened with us on many, many occasions with the three of us. It will happen in the future as well. So thank you.
When I was in Lesbos, I had a university professor as well who told me, if you want, I can put you to the local channel and you can start working here. So this doesn't mean that this was the only choice that I had and this was the opportunity. Maybe my career would have been totally different and could have been even better by having experience in a smaller place, because it's easier to work in a smaller place. It's easier to open your own blog. It's easier to work to the local paper or to the student paper, or things like that, to start and to have an experience, okay? So, I went and I studied arts, mass media and communications at the University of Athens. And now I'm doing a PhD, so I'm still a student at another university in Greece as well, again because I don't need to pay. And I'm doing a PhD on the war in Yugoslavia and how it was covered by British and Greek newspapers and comparing. The thing about luck also is that, as I said, you need to chase it. I see this wonderful university here that has, you know,
me in it.
Simple things.
This is what makes it wonderful.
Simple things that we have, like clean walls and internet and places where you can have a proper lecture, which is not the case in a lot of the places in the world, including Athens, not Lesbos, Athens especially, which is more like a political structure and not a university structure, usually.
And by political, he means a party political.
Party political, yeah, exactly. Yeah. So what I can tell you is that for my bachelor, I didn't really get too many things about being a journalist. I got more things about culture and life. For example, we had lessons about poetry and literature, which I loved, which when I was in school I hated, I have to say. But it was done in a totally different manner, and especially because we had to do only, instead of exams, we had to give papers. This was, you know, a very good thing for us. It was a fun thing to do. We had another one which was totally about jazz music, and we didn't have any musical instruments in the university. It was just studying about what is the jazz influence in the world. But we didn't have a radio station, we didn't have a newspaper, we didn't have anything. We had unions, which was very important. Chasing to have all these things and pushing. So again, I speak about luck because I was a student representative in the union. And what we did is that a political party organized a meeting to speak about the media and how the bosses basically take advantage of us. And there were people from all kinds of media, from blogs to television, and I was there as a student representative, and I made connections like this. And this is how I got my first job in the media, which was in a documentary series. This is my old boss. He has his show, our show anyway, has won about 10 international awards on international documentary issues. So I worked there for 2 years, and I didn't even immediately ask him for a job, I just spoke.
How did you get to meet him?
I met him on that meeting, like I said.
Right, okay, so he was at the meeting, okay.
Yeah, and I, you know, we said just hi, and we talk about television, not about, hey, I want a job, give it to me right now. But after a few months, I saw an advert, basically, that he wanted somebody for work experience. I called him and he remembered me. And he was quite friendly. You will see that there are people that are still friendly in the media business. And he said, yeah, of course. Welcome, come on in. So what I wanted to show you is the website so that you understand more or less what I'm talking about. This is the English website because they do the documentaries in English, Greek and Spanish. This is the last documentary, The Wicking Way. And they do 10 documentaries a year. It's a little bit like Dispatches, if you've ever seen, or Panorama, before Madeleine McCann documentaries, proper documentaries, okay? So, and of course they have a YouTube channel as well, with all their documentaries, where they give like 10 minutes of it, so that if you want, you can buy the rest, that kind of thing. So instead of having only the TV show, they are having an internet function as well, a website, you know, they're trying to do the proper thing. And this has been going on, not now, 8 years now, in 3 languages, as I said. I'll just show you a little trailer.
Can I just point out, as you're doing that, that this sort of media integration involves a lot of jobs. You know, to get TV material and have it uploaded and in 3 different languages, involves a lot of job opportunities for people. Now, this is of course something that it may sound a little distant for you, but there will be things like that happening here, and So there are a lot of things that somebody like you could do in terms of writing the material for it. So there are opportunities there, but no.
Like what Rilas is saying, I can give you immediately an example. Okay, if you want to have, if you want to do a documentary in a place that it is cheap and it is a little bit away from England, let's say you want to go to the Falkland Islands.
A little bit away from England?
Yeah, or far away from England, okay. Still British territory.
Yes, yes.
And you find somebody who speaks Spanish and you want to translate it so that it can play in all Latin America, then you can find a market for something very important. And you can do something that can be awarded, you know. So I'll just show you the trailer of a documentary they did about Greenland. Okay, after I left.
If one day the ice cap of Greenland were built completely, our life as we know it today would be completely different.
Basically, the ice is melting, 19 words for snow.
There's another thing that, as you were showing it, it came to me. Mm-hmm. There were quite a lot of jobs involved in the production of this, okay? Somebody needed to go and film it, editing, digital, whatever mastering it needed afterwards, post-production, music, somebody with the captions. And this sort of thing involves a lot of things that you can actually do as you are now. Some of it you will get, once you get into the business, then you also gain more expertise. You will become a better camera person, you will become a better writer for all sorts of media. But these sort of things exist and they do present opportunities.
I just wanted to say you're at a halfway point.
On the first documentary I worked on, I was just putting subtitles and something like this, okay? But I can tell you, since they just said this, it needs somebody to do a research for 6 months.
Yeah. Which you could
two or three people could do as you are, it needs somebody to organize the trip. It's usually called a fixer in the place.
Yeah.
Okay. So if they wanted to do a documentary about the UK, it could be you, especially if you have a good price and you have good connections. It involves somebody filming it and somebody doing the interview, so at least two people there. Okay. It involves, when they're back, somebody to do the website, somebody to make original music, yeah. Editors.
Even to organize all this, the production designer for all of this, yeah. Which is of
production,
course.
Of course. Yeah. And, at least 10 jobs that can be done by one person, but now, of course, it's a lot bigger show. Okay? So, after I left Greece, I came here and I did my master's in City University because I wanted to learn how to film properly and how to video edit properly, mostly. And I wanted to know the BBC style, okay? I have some reasons here, I'm explaining why I did what I did. But also I have to tell you that, again, this is how I got my job in Associated Press where I work. And not only me, a lot of people have been really successful from my year, from my course. I don't know if you know this person, Rana Davis. She writes in The Guardian and she appears very often on Sky News in weekends to comment on internal matters. I'll show you her website. Here you go. I don't know if you can see this. This is her blog, basically.
Okay. All of this, I know that to some of you it may sound like too much work to do, but a lot of it is sometimes automated. You do need to put in a lot of work to create a blog that looks as good as that, but a lot of it's automated. So for example, if you can you go back to it, please?
Yeah.
Okay, so some of them, there might be stuff that she wrote, Okay, but also you can also have automatic feeds, so some of these things get updated and they create traffic for your blog. So these are things that you learn, and they do make a presence of you. Vasilis was going to show you later how he has created a profile for himself as well. Go on. Sorry to interrupt.
So what I wanted to show you as well is the very good thing that happened was that our final project was to do a documentary of 7 minutes or more.
This is the master's project.
Okay. So I'm going to show it to you. It is a student project, but so it has mistakes. But the point is that before, I was just a member of a team of documentaries. And I came, I did these courses we were talking earlier, April, and I was able to do my own documentary. And now I know how to do it by myself, which is very important. So I'm going to show it to you. I hope it will play on full screen.
There's definitely a kind of backlash towards smoking by society as a whole.
It's your freedom to smoke. You can make any choice that you want, but smoke in your house, smoke in your backyard.
When I think about bars, the smell of beer and smoke comes to my nose. I'm kind of addicted to that.
Public health is clearly benefiting from being protected from indoor tobacco smoke. And I think it's something, a small sacrifice that smokers have to pay.
Why can't the technology today make it possible for weed smokers and their smoke to go up and not to harm the people around us?
Lighting up one of these in a pub was considered a common activity. Since July the 1st, the UK government decided to ban smoking inside all public places. Now, if somebody tries to light up a cigarette inside the bar or a pub, he could get a fine of £50, as well as the proprietor could get a fine of £2,500.
During the last 500 years, smoking has been a very popular habit across the Western world. It was Ramon Payne in 1493, a monk who accompanied Columbus on his second voyage to the New World, who firstly described how the Indians inhaled smoke through a Y-shaped tube. Enjoying tobacco became something common. In the 50s, smokers were considered sexy or sophisticated or mature in the West. During the 60s, though, the first scientific reports that discovered that smoking was responsible for numerous health problems was published in Britain.
Came out from the Royal College of Physicians in 1962, and it showed very clearly that smoking causes cancer, it causes lung cancer, but a range of other cancers like cervical cancer, mouth and throat cancer, and so on.
It can affect the vessels of the blood system, and they cause a condition called atherosclerosis, where there's hardening of the arteries, which then can lead you to things like heart attacks and strokes.
Almost 1 out of 10 deaths in Europe and Northern America is smoking related. Even though the health effects of smoking are known worldwide during almost half a century, there are numerous people that continue to smoke. In England, more than 10 million people smoke today.
In other words, one fourth of the adult population. He's not so much to show you that I don't want this to take all of the time. I know this is something that is very close to his heart because this is the MA project. It's something that, so this is something that is the result of an MA project. And how many people were involved in the making of it?
Well, basically, except for somebody helping me in a couple of things with the editing, I had a couple of other students that helped me film, and I helped them film their own final projects. So I don't know what you thought of it. It's definitely not something that could go out in the BBC today or something like that, but it was something that was decent. And it's something that if you have in your portfolio, which we're talking about, could be very important for your future to show that you're professional or that you're serious about
it. And also, this is the reason why this is more relevant to you is not only in case you go after journalistic jobs, it's that something. This is something that you could do to have as a portfolio to show that you're familiar with using cameras and editing. The university has enough equipment for you to rent out, but just borrow, and also come back and edit. So we've got enough stuff if you decide to do this. and you could create short films or whatever you think you're good at. I mean, Marcellus did it specifically in relation to a journalism MA, but you could do it in many different ways. So thank you.
Milk that.
Yeah, exactly. Milk the universe for
milk the universe as much as
exactly,
you can.
Yes.
Yeah.
This will be cut at the end.
Other things that I have to tell you while I was working at uni, I started trying to get a job as well and a work experience. I started working for Fora TV first of all, which was a website like YouTube, which was making only conferences and stuff like that. I hate them, don't work for them, they didn't pay me.
It's very important, this may happen to you.
This may happen to you as well, yeah. Keep the tapes, keep whatever you film or whatever you write. Keep copies, okay, so that you can prove things in the future.
Keep track of everything that you do for an employer, because you will have proof that you work, so they'll need to pay them, they'll need to pay them.
I worked for New Delhi Television as a camera operator. I went for AP, I went to AP for training. This was like, now, after Easter, back when I was in 2007, when I was a student. And this is because City University had a connection with AP, and I gave my best so that they would accept me to work in the future, okay, so that they would like me.
Can I stop you again? The uni here has connections with quite a few local media as well. But there you go, as he said, milk it. Now you have a connection with the AP, so talk to him. Right, so go on.
I tried to work for the Al Jazeera English back then. This is something that you will have a lot as well. They were like very positive. Yes, new brains, we like you. Didn't get it in the end. You will have that a lot. Actually, I have to tell you, 90% of the things that you want to do or you're thinking of doing or will not happen. But you still have to be positive. I even worked for GMTV. I don't know if any of you remember that show, you know, as a work experience, so that I could have it in my CV and so that I could see a different part of television or journalism or whatever you want to call it. I was going constantly to the Frontline Club. I don't know if you know what that is, in London.
It's on the next slide. We're going to talk about it.
I will talk about this in a bit.
But that's the next bit is the most important bit.
Yeah. And this was back when the crisis was not hitting us so hard. I applied for more than 20 jobs. Okay. And in the end, I got the AP one, which where they knew me from my work experience. So important to know, you know, that work experience opens the door, actually, sometimes.
But guys, the most important thing, and I will keep interrupting you with that, is that there will be a lot of rejection, and don't let it get to you. Okay, there will be a lot of rejection, and you need to get used to people saying, "Oh, we're very sorry, but we have no place for you at the moment. Maybe in the future, and so on." Just keep going. That's what gets the doors open. Just keep going.
Yeah, I mean, I know it's not normal, but it happens.
It may not be professional, but I'll work for free for a couple of weeks and then you see if you can
look at my application. Exactly. Once they know you, exactly. Yeah.
So, I'm putting this here because I actually had an experience of a very good friend of mine who became, because he was Greek, he basically pushed himself as an expert, not only in BBC and Sky, but in Al Jazeera as well. And spoke a lot about Greece, and then they were inviting him and paying him as well, and now he's doing documentaries in Greece about the crisis. Okay, so if you have a specific expertise, I don't agree in general with focusing on one thing, I have to say, especially about journalism, as we said in the beginning, it's not one thing, but if you are very good in one thing, like economy or sports or something very specific, follow that and you can have a career through this. Okay, I'm having a brief note about the Frontline Club because I was going there all the time in London because they have talks every week. Go to their website and try to get their newsletter for events that are very important. I've been there in dozens of talks and I've met dozens of journalists where even if you don't get a job or a good connection, you can actually, again, broaden your horizons, you know.
Somebody will know of an event happening somewhere and they'll say, "Hey, that's something I'm interested in, so I will go there." But that's how these things work as well.
So, now that I'm working at AP, now I'm working as a producer, that's how they call it here. What I do basically is that our correspondents send us pictures from all over the world. I edit them, I write the shot list and the storyline, okay? and I give it out to the client after a sub takes a look at it. Okay, this happened like in 10 different stories a day. I'm just having here, I don't want you to read all this, but just as an example of how many things I've gained from working in a big organization, which is the other part, except for blogging, doing things on your own and all that. I've learned so many things, and from 20 different positions, actually there are 21, but, and when I'm lucky to go outside and do stuff, I'm able to do things that I really like a lot as well. I'll show you, you know, video here from violence in Athens, 36,000 views. This was in December 2009, okay? If it decides to play. I'll just refresh. This was when the boy was killed in the 1 year anniversary.
You may not know about it. There was a 15-year-old boy who was killed by police in Central Athens.
So sometimes the job involves being inside riots or in a conflict with a very small camera like the one we got today. I was attacked by one of these guys, by the way, today. So by working in a big organization, I was able to get this number. This is in my CV of, I filmed something that 36,000 people have seen. Imagine my personal YouTube channel has about 4,000 views, okay? Just to tell you that it's not only all doom and gloom, I've done other things as well. Like the race for the Great Gorilla. This is a charity event, this happens everywhere in America.
Okay, yeah.
So, going back to where we were. Going back to AP then, I just wanted to show some of the products. You know, it's the biggest and oldest organization in the world. Since 1846, TV, print, radio, photos, we do everything, photo and iPad apps and everything that, you know, you can imagine. Websites, of course, client requests.
So all of these things are jobs that you could potentially get in terms of, you know.
And that I've done, right?
Yeah.
This is the most important thing I want to show you. This is me with my broken headphones. In the AP office. This was a photo that made big, made me look very big in Facebook among my colleagues because I was making fun of the company. This is how I would sell my profile today, okay?
Wait, who was making fun of the budget of the company being so big that everyone's headphones are broken?
Yeah.
So he's like, here I am with everyone's broken headphones, and
yeah.
Everyone went, love it.
So, I would give my Twitter account, my LinkedIn account, where I have all my profile, everything I've done.
Find him afterwards. Yeah, you can do it through me. Actually, I'll link you.
As I said, Vimeo is like an official YouTube channel for mainly journalists and artists who just put official work. My YouTube channel, of course, and my Facebook page. Briefly, very briefly.
On his Facebook page, just a quick note, he had his name spelled two different ways because in French, as he's working in multiple languages, in French they pronounce it differently. And so in order for them to find them, he has the English, Greek, and French versions as well.
So, you see, this is my Twitter account. First lecture, here I come. Whenever I do something, or whenever I think that something is important, I tweet about it. This is my LinkedIn profile. You can see my summary, my experience, you know, it goes on and on. I write everything that I think is important. My education, you know. This is very important because through LinkedIn, you can find a lot of jobs. It's very good. Try to get into LinkedIn and get into as many groups as possible. Okay. This is my Vimeo channel, where I've just have three things that I've done, and all of them are different things. This is a showreel for a band that plays music. This is a documentary about the Parthenon marbles, short documentary, and this is a festival that I filmed. Okay, so three different things, so that I can show that I can work in three different areas. This is my YouTube channel, where I have everything. This was a documentary I showed you earlier, for example, and things that I filmed from my phone. You know, in fact, this is a video I filmed yesterday, and it has 195 views till now. You know, with this gentleman over here. Not yesterday, sorry, Monday.
Monday.
Yeah. And my Facebook page. And I have it more because, not that it is a tool, to be honest, or it's not till now. They're trying to make it again a tool for work. But because all your employers, and keep it in your mind, will look at your website, will look at your Facebook. This is what they do. They are not allowed to do it, supposedly, but they do. Okay. So either hide it very well,
or just not have it silly things on.
Presentable, you know. I find that being in the social media is a little bit like getting into a room where you don't know anyone. You know, you won't show them everything, but you want to say, hi, how are you? This is me. This is who I am. Okay.
So, okay, try to, if you could cut to where you talk about difficulties and mistakes, because so
that we're going to scan through each one,
yeah. Yeah.
And then they can see what you're talking
so,
about.
So, just very quickly, the skill set. I think that number one nowadays is social media, actually. Again, YouTube, Twitter, Facebook, Flickr. Flickr is a very good website for photos, writing a blog. And also, this is what I was saying, branch out is the Facebook side of LinkedIn, okay? Languages. It's important to learn languages and to speak them. I have to tell you, I got the job in AP in the end because I was speaking Greek. It's the funniest thing ever, because there were fires in Greek, in Greece, and that's how I got the job. Practice. Try to take photos. Write down articles. Write a blog. Buy a video camera. You can buy a photo camera with £49 maybe right now that can take great video. And you can film things and
keep
it. Yeah, HD, and you can always have it everywhere on you, on your bag or whatever. And keeping on top of things like politics, art, and international relations are very important if you want to become a journalist or something very specific.
It's important for everything, because if you go for an interview and you are on top of politics issues, you're more confident when you're at it. Mm-hmm.
So, video cameras. I mean, there are big video cameras like the one that I have. These are the two cameras I have, the one that we have here right now. You can either buy a very big professional one that TVs use or whatever, but you can buy a very cheap one that you can have everywhere.
Why don't you save some of these details for if anyone wants to contact you with questions about cameras and programs after, and then you can go to the slides that are relevant.
Yeah. This is just, again, very quickly, these are four editing programs that are out available. I would recommend that this is the easiest one, iMovie, that all Apple computers have for free. So if you have an Apple computer, you can just use this one. Or else, if you have friends who are geeks with computers, they can give you all of these, okay?
Again, we're going to edit that out of this video here.
Because
that's illegal.
So, as I said, skills to keep sharp. International relations, politics, arts, and when I say arts, you need to be on top of things like cinema, you know, painting exhibitions, theater, music, etc. You know, all of this is very important, I think. Even to make conversation with people that you make as connections, you know. There are other things that are important for specific people. I don't know if you care, like sports. We have the Olympics now. Very important thing. A lot of careers in Greece started in 2004 after the Olympics, or with the Olympics. Again, economy and finance. I had to learn everything about economy because of the domain Greece, I mean, Lehman Brothers collapsing, okay? Radio production. You can even do it by from your house. You can even blog a radio production. Make it just for fun, you know? And other specific experts. I'll give you an example. We have a very good friend that now started filming only eco-architecture. And I told her this is a very good thing that she can put in her CV as a very specific thing that she can do in the future, you know? Challenges. Again, I have to say, difficulties as a student, you probably know that, you know, the mind that you have when you're 15 or when you're 20 or when you're 25 or 30 is very different. The balance in between having fun, enjoying what life is, understanding what your professors say, what is important and what is rubbish, and also trying to find a way of what you want to do in the future is very, very difficult task. I think you shouldn't stress about it, but you should find more or less what you want to do, not a specific goal, but what you want to do and chase it, okay? The difficulty is to find a job we spoke about earlier, okay? Don't lose your, how can I say, mojo if you don't get a job immediately, okay? Try to do whatever you can that it is around this. Difficulties in the job has to do mainly with how you can learn from being a student to being in a job, and how you can actually, unfortunately, even though journalists write opinion articles and they tell the truth and whatever, they have to follow orders. And this is a very difficult balance, okay? And also the difficulties to keep up with everything is that even though I tell you all these things, I really sometimes don't have the time as well to do all of these things that I want, you know? You keep on chasing, you keep on running behind time. You want the day to have 48 hours, basically. Okay. Mistakes. I've done many. I'll say some of them so that you can feel more comfortable. Okay. Now that we are the successful people, supposedly, as I even said. I did not like school at all. I hated it. And I decided that I didn't want to study. Okay. Some things I lost from that. Okay. Like I was learning German in school, and now I can't speak a word, to be honest. I can understand, but I was learning for 3 years. This is 3 years lost from something very important. Okay. I did not like photography when I was young, and now I have complaints from my fiancé till today that I'm not very good at it. And sometimes I cannot be a photojournalist because of this, because I can't get the moment or the right lighting or whatever. I did not like Twitter till very recently. I realized that it is a very useful tool, and I have to use it for connections, for everything. As soon as I got the job, a very important thing is that I stopped caring about everything. I was like, oh, now I got the job, I don't care. And I stopped filming for 1.5 years, and I realized that I missed it. And I fell behind. So you need to not lose your talents, not take them for granted, okay? I don't have enough time even now for my PhD. I started something that I'm not sure I can finish, which is sometimes embarrassing, you know? I'm sure that Rodriguez has a lot of these things to say for all of you ladies here. And again, as I said earlier, I'm just doing, I've counted about 30% of the things that I want. And I'm constantly running to do things, which is how to put your life in order. Very difficult thing when you're a journalist, I can tell you that. Because you become a journalist because you don't want your life to be in order, okay? So, last hints and tips, I have to say. Again, some of them are repetitions, unfortunately. Buy a video camera or a camera and start filming or take photos. Get an editing program, play with it. Or use the university, as we said.
Yeah. But also some of them you can find online and download for free.
Exactly.
Yeah, so
exactly. Sell your stories that you do or advertise them. Or if you can't sell them, put them out on your blog or your YouTube channel or your Vimeo channel or whatever. As I said, always have a camera with you. And very important, another thing that I wanted to say, make small groups if you can't find a job. Make a small group and, you know, make a movie or a video clip or a story. Go film something together. This is something that you can actually benefit all together, and working together is actually really fun, I have to say. Okay? And lastly, it is important to be part of the union because as jobs getting shorter and shorter, and people who want to become journalists are becoming more and more, they are trying to take our rights as much as they can. It is the only period in my life that I feel that I've learned more and more, and maybe now if I'm getting the market, I might not get a job, because there's cheaper labor all the time. And, you know, I'm not trying to be a communist here or anything, but the truth is that if workers are united in these kind of things, you can actually maybe have a pension at some point in your life.
Do you know whether you can join the union even if you don't have a job?
Yes.
You can.
Yes,
because, for example, for the teachers union here, you can. You need to be employed.
Yes, you can.
Yeah,
yes, you
can. Okay,
so, I wanted to show you this, what I told you about the Basel Festival, which is a festival that they filmed before, as a team of other people. Most of them didn't have a job, and we decided to do a film festival, a festival of immigrant workers in Greece at the time of racism and crisis, okay?
I don't think you have time for that.
That's all right, we'll run over anyway, don't worry. Show it.
And this is the last thing I'm going to show you, okay?
Afterwards and the linking as well. So thank you very much.